Hey creeps, how's it going? Cameron here. Some of you may be a little bit surprised to see me here on YouTube since I literally just ended the first season of Library Macabre. But I am still active on Patreon. So this is kind of a free Patreon video just to show you guys what you're missing over on Patreon. A lot of you have been saying in the comments of my last video that you're gonna miss my videos. And I was like, I still am doing videos. They're just over on Patreon. You can support me there for as little as $2 a month. There's an extra tier. It's $5 if you're feeling a little bit generous. And then there are other patrons of mine who do edit their pledges and give more. That's a choice. In order to get things from me, you just really have to pledge the $2. And there's over 100 videos. In fact, there's almost 200 videos over there now. So you would be getting access to all of that, including sneak peeks of my writing and, you know, a whole bunch of things. I do at least one video every week on Patreon. I have this show called The Library Macabre Show, where I talk about my writing, what I've read that week, what I've watched that week, and some of the things I've hauled that week. And I also often do more than one video. I'll often do two or three if I have other things I want to talk about or show. So I post a lot over there. Those videos are pretty much casual, unedited. If they do have any editing, it's very minimal, but it's just me kind of chatting off the cuff. So to all of my patrons, hello. Thank you all for your support. And I'm gonna do pretty much just the same thing I always do on Patreon. I'm going to talk about what I am reading, what I've been watching, how writing is going. And then I have a big stack of horror books here to haul. I have some vintage horror, some young adult horror, yada yada, all kinds of good stuff. So we're gonna start off with the writing because I just ended season one of Library Macabre. That means I am diving into my writing and trying to finish up book one of Autumn Crow High called Fresh Hell. I've been writing this book for a while. As you all have known, I have teased it a lot. The book honestly has just grown more and more and more in ways that I didn't think would happen. I started writing this as kind of just a throwback to young adult horror books. I thought it would be kind of cheesy and fun, and hopefully it is fun, but it's definitely gone above that. It is definitely a throwback to those books, but I've expanded on that a little bit more. What I typically write are kind of more melancholic horror stories, and Fresh Hell has definitely morphed into that. quite a lot, actually. So it's very dark. You know, it's young adult, but it is very dark. It's very gory. It's gruesome. Hopefully shocking in a lot of ways. I have been shocked while writing it. In fact, I wrote a certain scene last year that really upset me. I've never experienced this as a writer before. I've always enjoyed the writing process, but this was visceral for me. Like, I got done writing it and I was very upset. I felt sick. And I ended up taking a break, honestly, from writing it, which is another reason why it's taken me so long. And it's taken me a while to get back into it. So now I am back into writing. I'm hoping to have the book out this summer. Just a few chapters left, really. I am almost done with the book. I'm right at the end. The big chunk of the time is going to be just editing and getting the book formatted. So that's what I'm working on right now, and it is going well. I'm finding myself slipping right back into writing, which is such a relief because I was really, really worried that I wouldn't be able to. I was worried that I would sit down at the laptop and have nothing coming out of me. that was genuinely a worry of mine, but so far it's going really well, and I've come up with some new terrible scenes. So I hope you guys enjoy it once it's out. I'm hard at work on it, and I am excited to come back to YouTube, but it does feel good to just be focusing on nothing else but writing and Patreon, because like I said, still making Patreon videos. So there's the writing update. Now we're going to go on to my reading. Now, reading this week has been mostly pretty slow. I've had a little bit of time to read, but work has been very busy. I just haven't had as much time. So I did manage to read one book. It's a shorty, and it's not horror. To some of you, maybe this is horror. Some of you are going to scream when you see it. But I do like these books. They're cheesy. They're fun. They remind me of my childhood, because this is how everything was back then. Here we have Sweet Valley High, book number one, Double Love, created by Francine Pascal. So the Sweet Valley series, it does have some horror additions to the series, but this first book is mostly just a contemporary story, a cheesy soap opera kind of story. I wouldn't even really call this one a romance so much, because there's not that much romance involved. In fact, it does read like a Fear Street book, just without the horror elements. Actually, this feels a lot like Fear Street to me. So for those who aren't familiar, Sweet Valley High came out in the 80s, the early to mid 80s, and featured these two twins that go to Sweet Valley High. And these twins, I mean, you can tell there's Elizabeth Wakefield, who is the older one. She's older by like 4 minutes. She's the smart one, the clean-cut one, the one that doesn't really rebel. And then you've got Jessica Wakefield, who's a few minutes younger, spunky, to say the least. She is a character, and she's not exactly good. Like, Jessica's actually, I wouldn't say evil, but there are times where I'm like, she is evil. She kind of reminds me of Reva Dalby from Fear Street. So she's just very manipulative and a total narcissist, if I've ever seen one. And I have, believe me. So yeah, we've got Jessica and Elizabeth, who are twin sisters. They love each other, but they have a lot of conflict, mostly because Jessica just can't stop causing problems. So in this first book in the series, now I have read some other Sweet Valley books. I've read a lot of the middle grade books, actually, the Sweet Valley Twins and Friends. This was my very first Sweet Valley High, and I'm not going to talk a whole lot about it, so don't worry, I am going to get into the other things here in a minute. But this book is just so much fun, and it really does feel like a soap opera. It's a little melodramatic. You've got Elizabeth, who is kind of in love with this guy, but is too shy to talk to him. And then you've got Jessica, who's like, well, I can't have any of that. I can't have my sister in love with this guy. I need him for myself. So she kind of swoops in and starts lying and manipulating the situation and turning them on each other so that way she can have him. Not really because she wants him, but because she just can't really see anybody else liking her sister more than her. So it's really bad. And there are things that she does in this book that just is so infuriating, but I was eating it up. Like, I'm loving it. So really what I want to do is read this, which I have, and then skip forward to some of the other books in the series that are more horror focused. Like, there's one called Camp Killer, which is a slasher at a camp, from what I can see based on the synopsis. I'd really like to read that next, which is book 100 and something in the series, and compare it to this and see how far the series stretches. So there are books featuring werewolves, there are books featuring vampires, there's a horror middle grade series called The Frightening Four, which looks genuinely pretty creepy. There's all kinds of stuff going on in Sweet Valley, and I really want to dig into more. So that's one thing I want to do. I've read this, I want to jump forward, read some of the horror Sweet Valley books, and see what I'm missing, because I think it's gonna be a blast. So I read Sweet Valley High, book number one, Double Love. I've also been watching some things. I haven't watched quite as much as I usually do, but I have watched a couple of things. So when it comes to TV, I have been binging Charmed. This is Charmed, the complete seventh season. I recently got the complete series on Blu-ray, so it's been really cool to revisit the show in high definition. It looks beautiful. Like, I didn't think Charmed could ever look this good. It's really a beautiful looking show. Charmed is one of my favorite shows from when I was a kid. Watching it now, I back in the day thought it was a great show. Like, to me, this was just as good as Buffy. I watched Buffy recently, and now watching this, it's like, no, it's not as good as Buffy. It's popcorn. It's just a good old time. You got three sisters who are witches, and they cast out demons, and it's great. It's really fun. So season 7 is off to a really good start. I don't think I've seen any of season 7, if I'm being honest. I think I only really watched the first few seasons and then caught some episodes here and there after that. So a lot of this isn't ringing a bell for me at all. It's like I'm watching this for the first time. So I probably am. But so far, I'm loving how it's starting off. There are times where Charmed kind of loses its way and then it returns back to its roots. And you get that craziness again. And that's what this season has so far. And I'm liking it. I think it's doing some cool stuff. I also picked up the 4K steelbook of Rebel Without a Cause with James Dean and Natalie Wood. I picked this up recently and talked about it on my Patreon, here on Patreon, when I bought it, but I hadn't watched it on 4K yet. So this is one of my favorite movies. I've loved it since I was a teenager, but it was a whole other experience visiting it on 4K. It looks beautiful. It's so colorful and just a gorgeous film. So I really enjoyed watching this on 4K Blu-ray. It's a beautiful steelbook edition too. I don't know if this is still in print. It might be out of print already, but of course you can get the regular 4K edition if you want. So Rebel Without a Cause with James Dean, one of the greatest movies ever made in my opinion. I love it. It's classic. And just today, actually, I watched an 80s slasher film. This is called The Scare Maker, aka Girls Night Out. So this is your basic 80s slasher. You've got a bunch of college kids that are about to do this big scavenger hunt for school. And there is a killer going around wearing this mascot costume. It's a bear, and he's got these knives as claws, and he's going around and slashing the kids on campus. So these kids are, they're your basic slasher caricatures. They're bigger than life, very obnoxious and loud. But overall, I liked the acting. I liked the direction. I liked the twist at the end, even though I did see it coming pretty much immediately. It's nothing too surprising. But I liked it, and I thought the killer is very creative. I liked the costume, the bear costume. I thought it was cool. So, it's a cuddly bear, a big cuddly teddy bear with razor claws, dripping blood. So, I liked it. I would recommend it if you like 80s slashers. If you're not a slasher fan, you're not gonna like it, plain and simple. All right, so that's everything I've read, everything I've watched this week, some of the writing I've been doing. Now it's time to haul some books. So I've gathered up a lot of the horror books I have, and we're gonna look at those. So I've got a couple of very rare ones in this stack, which has me very excited. So this is one of those. This is Petals on the Wind by V.C. Andrews. Not a book that's rare necessarily, it is still in print, but this is a first printing of the paperback with the step back art. I've been searching for this forever and ever and ever, literally years, and I've not been able to find one. This was at Half Price Books for like $5, I think, and it's in pretty good shape. There's some spine creases, but it's not that bad. And this is a first print. It's such an exciting feeling to find this. I recently read Flowers in the Attic, reread Flowers in the Attic, and have been wanting to read Petals on the Wind because I've never read the sequel before. So now I can finally do that. So I'm going to be doing that soon. Just so glad to have the book. It's about time. I also found this copy of V. This is a novelization of the original miniseries. It's in pretty good shape. I have seen the miniseries, though I don't think I've seen the original 10-hour miniseries. I think I saw the remake they did, like in the early 2000s. So V is something I think I need to track down and see. So It's cool to have the book, though. It's a nice big chunker, and this does adapt all 10 hours of the miniseries, so that's pretty cool. This is actually a fantasy book, but it looks creepy to me, so I thought this is something maybe horror adjacent that I could talk about. It's called After Dark. It's by Manly Wade Wellman. I just thought this looked really creepy. I love this cover art. Got this kid, this unsuspecting kid down here playing guitar, and these creepy guys hunched over him. Just looks very cool to me. I found this at Half Price Books for, I think it was like $1.20. So it was very cheap. Just looked cool. If you've read this book or any of these books, let me know what you thought, because I've not read it yet. Next up, we've got lots of teen horror, vintage teen horror, including some rarities like this one here. This is Graveyard Moon by Carol Gorman. This is one I've been seeking out for the longest time and finally got a good deal on a copy of this. Usually it's too expensive, but I got a good deal. So it says, when the moon is full, none but the dead is safe. And then the back says, the graveyard is dark and deathly still, filled with shadows and snakes, cold granite headstones, and talk of unsettled spirits. It's part of the initiation. In the distance, a gnarled tree stands silhouetted against the moonlit sky. Go there, Kelly is ordered. It's part of the initiation. In the blackness, her eyes catch a shape in the shadows, and her own scream pierces the night air. At her feet, the eyes of a blood-splattered statue stare up at her, its mouth open, frozen in an expression of unspeakable horror. The initiation is over. For Kelly, the terror has just begun. So, sounds neat to me, very atmospheric. I love a good cemetery scene, what can I say? So this seems like it has it, and I will be very excited to read it. Now this is one I have read already. This is Terror Academy, book number 15, Boy Crazy. I do own a copy of this, but this one was just in such nice condition, much better than the copy I have. So I picked this one up, couldn't pass it up. Very rare these Terror Academy books are. I did manage to find one more of them though. This is Student Body, and it's also in beautiful condition. I loved Boy Crazy. It's disturbing though, and really mean-spirited. So it's like Fear Street, but on steroids, basically. So I'm very excited to read this one because you've got your classic slasher image here with the yearbook and then the pictures are crossed out. So I can only imagine what this is going to be like. Probably a lot like Fear Street, but a little darker, a little bloodier. This is a very obscure young adult horror series that I recently found out about. Didn't know about it prior. This is The Bug Files, book number one, Squirmsters. Squirmsters! That title! I want to write a book called Squirmsters. This is by David Jacobs. I recently got books 2, 3, and 4. I just needed book 1. So I grabbed it. I'm very glad I did. There are, I believe, 7 books in the series altogether, 6 or 7. And I want to do like a reading vlog when I come back in season 2. If you guys want. It's kind of a weird choice for a reading vlog, but it would be cool to kind of dig into some of these rarer, more obscure titles and see what they're actually like, if they're actually any good, if they're worth tracking down. Here's another one that's very rare, The Dark by M.C. Summer. It says, where the terror lives and everything else dies. A very beautiful, shiny copy. I have quite a few books by M.C. Summer. I just haven't read any of his books yet, or her books. It says, beware the dark, you'll never escape. Something lives in the dark, something evil. It's been asleep for a long, long time, but now it's awake. The thing is hungry. It will get you. It will get you. It's gonna get you. Better watch out. I also have quite a few point horror books here. Most of these are replacements for other books in my collection because these are just so shiny and pretty, and I needed them to replace my other ones. So we've got Amnesia by Sinclair Smith. I love this shiny, sparkly font. Looks very cool. This copy is so pretty. Look at that. Looks brand new. My other one is okay, but not as nice as this. So I had to pick this one up. Same case for the yearbook by Peter Laranges. It's another classic image there. I love a good yearbook with scratched out pictures. Very nice copy. Just so pretty. Another replacement, Be Mine by Jane McFan. A little confession. I recently did a short here on YouTube where I recommended some Valentine's Day books. And I, at the beginning of the video, was balancing all of the books on my head. And I was so worried to do it because I was worried I was going to drop all the books and damage them. And I did end up dropping them. Actually, right after I hit stop on the camera, I ended up dropping the books. And they were all fine, except for this one. Ended up getting a big old crease in the cover, and I was so mad at myself. And I was like, you know what, I need to get a new copy of this, otherwise it's going to bug me forever. And the copy I had wasn't perfect to begin with. It did have some spine creases and some damage on the back cover. So I wanted to replace it anyway, but the fact that I caused the damage just really bothered me. So I'm glad I could get a nice minty copy of this to replace my other one. This copy is beautiful. Here's another replacement, The Stranger by Caroline B. Cooney. Gorgeous condition and the most amazing cover of any of the point horror books. I love that cover. If you're wondering what I'm going to be doing with my dupes, I do plan on listing some books for sale on eBay or Etsy or Pango Books or one of those. I'm not sure yet. I just want to get done with the book first, but I will be listing some books for sale. I'm not going to charge a ton of money, don't worry, but I do want to try to make a little bit of money back on some of the books that I've been buying lately. Here is another replacement. This is Mother's Helper. My copy was like a third or fourth printing, so I wanted to get a first print to replace it, and I finally found one. And these were all very cheap. I didn't pay very much for any of these, maybe like $3 or $4 each. Here's a big one. This is the only Fear Street Nights book that I was missing. I do have another copy. It's not a first print, but this is a beautiful first printing, which means my collection is totally complete. This is a very rare book. It goes for so much money online, but I finally got a copy for under $10, which is what I was aiming for. You can always get these books for an affordable price. Don't pay what they're asking for online. Just wait. Wait a little bit. Keep an eye out. Set alerts on your phone, and eventually you will get them for a good price. So I'm just going to throw that out there. Speaking of Fear Street, I didn't think I was going to collect any of these, but I think I've changed my mind. I'm going to do it. This was actually a gift. I didn't actually pay for this one myself. This is the new edition of Fear Street Night Games. Now, there are many new editions out, and I don't have any of those. But I think I'm going to start buying them because I can't help it. I'm a completionist, and I want all the Fear Street books. So, yeah, I'm going to start dipping my toes into these and trying to find them for a good deal. The covers on these are okay. Some are better than others. This one's fine. I really like the cover. You probably can't see because it's too small. I like Perfect Date. That's a good cover. And I do like the new cover for the Cheerleaders bind up that they put out. I thought that looked pretty cool. So I am going to try to grab that one. More R.L. Stein. We've got Goosebumps Series 2000, Book 3, Creature Teacher. So this is a first printing. Mine was a later print. So I was happy to grab a first printing of this one. I love these embossed covers. These are so crazy. Everything is embossed. It's nuts. Look at all those teeth. They don't make covers like that anymore. I also have a first printing of Goosebumps Night of the Auditorium. I bought this because it was a beautiful mint condition first printing. I really needed one for my collection. And it arrived, and it is in good shape, but it got dented here at the bottom. which a lot of you are probably like, oh, that's not a big deal. But it was in mint condition until they shipped it out and they didn't package it very nicely. So it really bothers me that that big dent is there. But otherwise, it's in good shape. I'm trying not to fret about it too much. I also got a first print of Are You Afraid of the Dark? The Tale of the Restless House. And it's got that glow-in-the-dark cover. I am trying to complete my collection of these Are You Afraid of the Dark books, but they're so rare and everybody wants so much money for them online. But I did get a good deal on this one. So at least there's that. But there's the other books in the series, which are so rare, and I never see them go for sale. So I don't even know when I'm going to have the opportunity to buy those. These are really gross and really cool. So here we have some books from the Barfarama series, which I didn't know existed, but I saw them on eBay and they caught my eye, obviously. this is a 90s middle grade series. And it's called Dog Do Afternoon. We've got To Wee or Not To Wee. That's a Tim Jacobus cover right there, the illustrator of the Goosebumps covers. So he did a couple of these books as well. And then we've got Scab Pie. These are all by Pat Pillari, who is actually K.A. Applegate, who wrote the Animorphs series. So she actually wrote these too under a pen name. So this is book 5, 6, and 7. There are actually like 15 or more books in this series, and I really want to track them down, but they are extremely rare. So I'm going to try my best, but I don't know where to find these. If you know anything about these books and where I can find some copies of these, or you have some and you wouldn't mind selling them, let me know because I would love to have the rest of this series. Next, we have Zombie Queen by Don Whittington. This is the last book I needed in this series. I don't know what the series is called. I don't think it even has a name. It just says, look for more scary adventures with Winston and friends in these books. And there's actually 6 books in the series. And this was the last one I needed. They all have really cool embossed covers. They're all from, of course, the late 90s, maybe even the mid 90s. Yeah, mid 90s, mid to late 90s. Just a really cool looking series. I've not read these yet, but they're very short, and I would like to try to get to them sooner rather than later. Here's one I saw at Half Price Books, and even though I already have a hardcover copy of this, I couldn't pass up the paperback because it's got a really cool cover that's totally different from the hardcover. So this is Alfred Hitchcock's Ghostly Gallery. Look at that beautiful cover art. So the hardcover book is pretty cool too, but it's got a much different cover. And I think I like the paperback a little bit more. Just very cool. No illustrations in this. That's the good thing about the hardcover is that it is completely illustrated with color illustrations. This is simply just for the cover that I bought this one. This is something cool that you guys might like to know about. So the Creepers series by Edgar J. Hyde is a middle grade horror, kind of a Goosebumps knockoff from the late 90s. It started, I think, in 1996 or 97, and it ran for over 20 books. It is now being reprinted in these new editions, and you can actually get 5 of the books at the Dollar Tree. So if you have a Dollar Tree anywhere near you, these are only $1.25. So I picked up a couple that I needed. I already had the other ones, so I didn't bother to pick those ones up. The only thing that really bothers me about these books is that they've been renumbered. So they're renumbered 1 through 5, even though these books are not 1 through 5. So I don't know why they were renumbered for the Dollar Tree, but that's what happened. So that really bothers me. They don't sync up with my other books in my Creepers collection. I really want to get the original Creepers books. It was called Shivers originally in the UK. Actually, I think in Australia. And then it was changed to Creepers. I wonder if it had something to do with the Shivers series by M.D. Spencer. Maybe there was some conflict there. But the original Creepers covers are really cool and very cute. And I'd love to track those down, but they're hard to get here in the U.S. because they are foreign editions. So you can get these originals, or these reprints, though. They're cool. They're not as good as the original covers, but they're still pretty neat, I have to say. So there are the Creepers books. I also just recently got the last book I needed in the Scary Mysteries for Sleepovers series. Unfortunately, I had to go with thrift books, and it did not arrive in the condition described, which happens all the time. It's all bent up, and it's got this terrible sticker on the cover, and it's got, like, the spine is ripping down here. It's like a bug that was squished in the book, so it's in terrible shape, but I don't know. I'll find another copy to replace this one. At least I now have all four of these Scary Mysteries for Sleepovers books. And we've got two more. So this next one was another one that I got at Thrift Books, and it was supposed to be in, like, new condition. It ended up arriving as a library hardcover copy, but I was able to clean it up, and it looks pretty good. So I'm not too mad about it. This is The Headless Haunt and Other African-American Ghost Stories. I almost forgot to tell you what it's called. I just thought the cover looked really cool, and I really wanted to have it in my collection. This is definitely something I would have wanted to read when I was a kid. And I'm surprised I didn't, because this is from, what, 1994, I think? Yeah, 94. I don't know why I didn't know about this book, because I would have totally jumped at this book. It looks very cool. So I grabbed a hardcover first edition of that. And here's one that was also a gift. I was a little bit on the fence about it, but I'm really glad to have it. And I do want to try reading it soon, though I feel like it's going to be a challenge. This is the new Choose Your Own Adventure book, the Stranger Things edition. This is called Heroes and Monsters. It's thick. Most of the Choose Your Own Adventure books are very short. I can't imagine how challenging it's going to be to read a Choose Your Own Adventure book this big. But I think it's cool that they teamed up with Stranger Things to do an official Choose Your Own Adventure Stranger Things book. And I really needed it for my Choose Your Own Adventure collection. So it's got illustrations. Looks very neat. There doesn't seem to actually be a lot of choosing going on here, flipping through this book. There doesn't seem to be lots of options. I think mostly you're just going to read this from beginning to end. Maybe switch it up a little bit, but for the most part, you're probably going to end up reading the whole book at the end of the day anyway. So maybe it won't be very difficult to read. But it's cool just for the aesthetic of it, I guess. I'm really glad that I was able to get that. So, yeah. Thank you guys for watching. I hope you enjoyed this free little Patreon video. Again, to all my patrons, thank you so much for your support. You guys are awesome, and I really, truly appreciate everything you do for me. And then to everybody else, thank you for watching. Thank you for commenting and liking my videos, and just giving me support and helping me to keep doing this. Thank you guys so much. I will catch you very soon when season 2 is back.